Good morning.
There we go.
Welcome to Oakway United. We'll give everyone a second to settle in. We've been visiting this morning. Welcome. All right, we're continuing our series on what Jesus said, and we will be reading today from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 29. So if you'll stand with me, we're going to try reading all together. So the words will be coming up on the screen, and you can read along with me. Alrighty. All right. So 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 29. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup." I'm sorry, I said it wrong. Let's try again. Where are we? Okay. After supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whoever eats this bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves." All right, will you join me in prayer? We're going to consecrate ourselves to the Lord. We welcome you, God. Father God, we worship you. We pray that by the blood of Jesus and by your Spirit whom Jesus sent, please cleanse me, fill me, purify me, bring order in me. In a heart waiting on you, hungry for you, bring your perfect ways, your perfect law, your perfect exchanges. Let my heart be a holy resting place for your presence, a resting place for your glory, now and always. Be with us, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
the opportunity to praise him for the forgiveness through his son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood.
Thank you for this time and these people. We pray that you are present, so present and transforming in the reading of your word today. In your son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Is that better? Oh, there it is. All right. I will try not to be such a hand talker today, but that is really difficult for me. Can y'all hear me? Oh, yes, children, you may go. If you would like to follow Miss Renee, she is heading upstairs for our children's message. So last year, I had probably one of the funniest experiences I've had since we moved to South Carolina. Sometimes I will say something and y'all just kind of look at me like, what are you talking about? And sometimes y'all say something, and I'm like, I have no idea what that means. And I was just getting to know my companion teacher. I work with her every day. And one day, I don't remember what happened. I just remember we had kind of a trying day. I don't think it had anything to do with the children, but I think just something was going on, and it was just frustrating. And I was sitting at my table, which is just a few feet away from her table, and we were, you know, just kind of doing our own thing, and I was preparing something. I was probably cutting or you know, getting papers ready, and out of nowhere, she goes, I'm so ill. And I looked at her, and I'm like, well, that's a weird thing to just say. And she looks over at me, and she goes, I'm ill. And I said, what's wrong? Like, is your stomach not feeling good? Have you got a headache? Like, I know it's been a rough day. Like, what doesn't feel good? And she looks at me like, where are you from? I said, you feel sick, right? She said, no, I'm ill. And like, she's really using the word ill. And I said, I hear that you're ill. I know that means you're sick. She goes,
She just starts laughing. She loses it. Apparently, when you say that you're ill, you mean you're really mad. I learned that day. I had no idea. That's a Southern thing. And so whatever she was mad about, whatever was making her upset, was gone out the window because she was laughing at me. Not like, this is funny. She's like, okay, yeah, this is ridiculous. You don't know what ill means. And I'm like, but you don't know what ill means. And we talk about that from time to time. We both knew what it meant, but we knew a different meaning. We both knew that it meant something important. We were saying the same thing, but we weren't on the same page. And today, as I was studying, we're talking about communion today. If you haven't guessed, between the scripture we read this morning and the elements here on the communion table, as I was studying, I just kept thinking, I mean, these guys have no idea what Jesus is saying, do they? Jesus is telling them something really important, and they're like, uh-huh, okay. But there's no way that they completely understood what he was saying because it wasn't yet fulfilled. So they were having the same conversation, but it wasn't quite the same conversation. Does that make sense? Jesus was telling the disciples, I'm doing something here that's important. I want you to keep doing it. And they're like, okay. Well, when they knew what the Passover was, but communion is something a little bit different. They didn't get it. Today, we're going to kind of dig into that. We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 22. This is happening right before the Passion begins. I mean, this is like the famous painting, The Last Supper. All 12 of the disciples and Jesus are at the table. This is the last time he has all 12 of them together, because it is from this meal that Judas will leave to go and betray Jesus. This is the 12 of them and Jesus together around the table, celebrating this final moment where it is all of them at one time. And Jesus gives them probably one of the most, at least interesting conversations, but a very important conversation. It's where he begins this process, this moment we call communion that will continue for the rest of church history. It will continue until it reaches fulfillment in heaven. I want to read to you just 7 verses of what Jesus says. Luke 22, I'm going to read verses 14 to 21. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you, but the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The first thing that Jesus says here is that Passover is not finished yet. Did you catch that? He's telling them, I've been longing to eat this meal with you. He says, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you. This means he's been longing for it. He's been looking forward to it. Like he couldn't wait to have this supper with them. And he says, we're sharing this meal, but I'm not going to eat it again until it finds its fulfillment in heaven. Until it finds its fulfillment in heaven. It means it's not fulfilled yet. They're gathered together celebrating the Passover, which is one of the most important events that has happened in Jewish history. This is the moment that the Israelites look back to as we call it their salvific moment. The moment that God saved them. When we look back in the Old Testament, we look at the story of Exodus. what we see is Moses being called to set God's people free. The Israelites were the people of God. He had chosen them. He had said, follow me and I will be your God. And whenever the land goes into a severe famine, he rescues them by sending Joseph down to Egypt, where he becomes second in command. He's only next to Pharaoh, and he has them bring all of the family down. So the whole nation of Israel, those founding members, those brothers, they're all in Egypt, and they're welcomed in as honored guests, and they're given the best of the land. But as they stay there, they become not honored guests, but they become the slaves of the Egyptians. They become the people that they will use to build their empire. 430 years pass between when they go down into Egypt until God calls them out. And what he does is he uses the man named Moses, a man who should have died at birth, who should have been thrown in the river with the crocodiles. And he was, but his mama put him in the basket. He was saved out of the river. He grew up in Pharaoh's palace. And when he was older, and he defended an Israelite from being beaten, from the cruelty of the slavery, he went too far and he killed the man, and he had to flee for his life. He runs from his people. He runs from Egypt. He runs away. But while he is a stranger, while he is a foreigner, God calls him and says, I chose you. You will go back to the land of Egypt. You will be used to rescue my people. He comes in the burning bush and he sends them, and Moses doesn't want to go. He says, no, I can't do that. He says, but you can. And he sends them back and he says, go to Pharaoh, tell him, let my people go. So he goes. He meets up with his brother Aaron, and the two of them go to Pharaoh and they say, let our people go. Pharaoh doesn't let him go. And this happens 9 times, right? You read through the book of Exodus, you will see God systematically dismantling the nation of Egypt. He is matching them and surpassing them. He sends plagues, plague after plague. You see their livestock becomes no more, and their crops become no more. And as the Pharaoh refuses to let God's people go, the plagues increase in severity until finally they've done this song and dance 9 times. Moses goes and says, let the people go. God says, let my people go. And Pharaoh says, no. And sometimes he'll say, yeah, sure, and then change his mind as soon as the plague is gone. And God says, I'm going to send one more. He gives warning. He says, let the people go or something really bad is going to happen. And Pharaoh doesn't let the people go. So God says, okay, Moses, you got to tell the people. They got to do something here. I want you to have them sacrifice a lamb. And he gives the way that they're supposed to do it. And they're not supposed to break bones. And they're supposed to eat it at a certain time. And then cook it a certain way. And he says, but what I want you to do is, as you gather and you have these meals, I want you to take the blood from this animal that is being sacrificed. And I want you to paint the doorposts, the sides and the tops of your doors with it. I want you to put the blood around the door of your home, and I want you to stay in there. Don't come out for any reason. Put the blood on the door and stay inside, because the angel of death is being sent that night. And those people who do not have the blood of that lamb on their door, the angel of death is going to visit their home, and he will strike down the firstborn in Egypt. The Israelites obey. They put up the blood of the lamb on their door. And when the angel of death comes, he doesn't touch a hair on their head. Nothing bad happens in Israel because they heard the word of God and they obeyed. But the Egyptians did not. And they experienced great loss. Even Pharaoh lost his firstborn. And it was at this that the people were finally let go. And as they leave and they're following God and they're rejoicing, and Pharaoh tries to get them, God protects them. And what ends up happening is Pharaoh and the rest of the army that's left alive, they end up being washed away by the Red Sea. God delivers his people from slavery. He delivers them from the land of Egypt. He rescues them when they cry out to him. It is this moment that whenever we look in scripture and we're reading through the Psalms and we're reading through the other stories and they say, but this is the God who rescued you with a mighty arm, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. This is the moment that the Jewish people look back to and say, that is when God saved us out of Egypt, when he brought us out of bondage, when he set us free from slavery, when he made us free and he gave us the chance to be his people. This sounds an awful lot like the work of Jesus on the cross to me. This is the moment when Jesus will go to the cross. He's telling them, I'm gonna give you this blood and the wine, the juice. We call it juice. I'm gonna give this. And you're going to have this bread, and you're going to do this in remembrance of me. And they're eating the Passover meal. They're eating this meal that is looking back to the salvific act that God has done in the people of Israel, that where he saved them from the land of Egypt, where he saved them from their enemies. And they're celebrating this meal, and Jesus says, this is what I'm going to do. This isn't fulfilled yet. Because Jesus knows that it's the next day that he will go to the cross, and he will become that lamb that was sacrificed once for all time, where he will become the sacrifice that will take away our sin. You see, Passover was an event that happened, and it is something that took place in the book of Exodus, and it set the people free, but it's something that is still happening because of the work of Jesus. Because of Jesus, who knows he's going to the cross, we can be saved. We can be set free from the bondage of the enemy. We can be liberated. We can be made right. And he's saying, do this. I'm not going to eat this meal again until it reaches its fulfillment in heaven. He looks forward to the kingdom of God, is what he says, when we will all celebrate together, because when we believe in Jesus, did you ever hear the phrase, we are washed in the blood of the Lamb? I know that sounds odd if you've never heard that before. We think of, oh, I don't want to be washed in anyone's blood. But the symbolism there is the blood around the doorframe marks that house as one that belongs to God. And when we talk about being washed in the blood of the Lamb, it is that blood that marks us as God's own. So whenever death approaches, whenever our bodies get to the point of death, it's like death passes over us because we go on to life. Death can't hold us. We go on to life. Death just passes over us. Our bodies will die. We will go dust to dust and ashes to ashes, but our spirit will go on because it cannot hold us. And it is the blood of the Lamb that marks us as his own. And Jesus says, I'm not going to eat this Passover meal again until it reaches its fulfillment in the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God. Can you imagine the day that we all celebrate? The day where we step from death into life, where we celebrate this meal with our Savior in heaven. It's still happening. Jesus is still setting people free. This is one of those things we talk about in Scripture. We talk about it being now and not yet. It's something that's happened, but it's something that's still going on and will still go on, and it's not fulfilled yet. And I was trying to think of a way to explain this, and interestingly enough, I came back to the idea of movies. You see, I hate the credits on the movies. Does anybody else really not care for the credits at the end of a movie? We would go to the movie theater a fair amount. We used to live next to a theater where it was $3 to go. So we went a lot. And I'm like ready to go as soon as the movie's over. But somebody over here likes to say for the extra credit scenes. I didn't know those were a thing. I really didn't. And when I found out they were a thing, I was like, oh, we have to stay. It's like 3 minutes. I've been sitting in the theater for like 2 hours. I didn't mind about that. But you ask me to sit for 3 minutes and watch the credits, I'm just like, this doesn't end. But then I started kind of appreciating them because you have the movie. It's the thing that's already taken place, right? And then there's this kind of time where we wait, and sometimes it feels like we wait forever, but then you get that extra credit scene, and it tells you something either really important about the thing you just saw, or it tells you something about a movie or a plot line that is going to come. So you have everything that you've already seen. You have this new addition, this new revelation to the movie that you've just seen. And more times than not, it looks forward to what's coming next because it's probably Marvel and they're probably trying to get you to come and see the next movie. The Passover was an event that happened in the history of Israel where he saved his people literally from the nation of Egypt, where he rescued them. He brought them out of slavery. He made them a great nation. And then we have Jesus who came and they didn't understand what was happening just yet. And Jesus is telling them ahead of time, because this is literally happening within the next 24 hours, less than that actually. I'm gonna do something. And instead of just rescuing one nation and one people, this is going to be something that all people can have. And then someday we're all going to celebrate when we get to heaven, because there's going to be more and more and more people who celebrate this being rescued and being saved and being set free from bondage. And when we reach fulfillment in heaven, when we all get there, then we will all celebrate in the kingdom of God. Passover is not yet finished. Amen. He is still working. The next thing that Jesus points out here, and I think is so important, is that he gave his body and he gave his blood. Okay, we know communion, we talk about the bread represents the body of Jesus and the blood is represented by the grape juice or the wine, depending on your tradition. But when we look at this passage, the way that Jesus explains it, in verse 19 and 20, he says, "And he took the bread, he gave thanks and broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body given for you.'" And then he says, "In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you.'" He's telling the disciples, "I'm giving my body for you. I'm pouring out my blood for you." Jesus chose to do this for us. He knew what it meant. He knew that his body was going to be broken. He knew that within a matter of hours, they would go to the Mount of Olives and he would pray. And we see his prayer where he says, "God, I really, 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 I don't want this pain and suffering that's coming for me, but I will do it. If this can't be done another way, I will do it. May your will be done." But here at this supper, he says, "I'm going to do this for you. Here is my body. Take it. This is my body broken for you. And here is my blood. I'm pouring it out for you." The disciples do not yet know what's going to happen to Jesus. They have no idea that he is going to the cross. They don't know that later in the garden, he is going to be arrested. They don't know about the trial, and they don't know about the beatings and the mocking and the torture and the cross. They don't know, but Jesus knows, and he says, "But I'm giving myself. I'm giving my body for you. I'm pouring out my blood for you." In the Old Testament, when they would make sacrifices, they would go up to the tabernacle or to the temple later, but right now we're studying about the tabernacle and how God has so arranged the camp of Israel and all of the sacrifices that need to be made and how to do them. And there's very specific instructions that when you want to make a sacrifice, that you take the animal up to the tent of meeting or to the temple and you take it and you place your hands on it and the animal is given and prepared in a certain way. And something I didn't know is that they would take the blood and they would actually pour that out. They wouldn't pour it on the altar or anything because that wasn't prescribed, but they kind of just pour it out on the coals because it was such a moment of somberness where it's a life being given. See, the Israelites understood that someone's life was in the blood. The life was in the blood. The Old Testament says so many times, don't eat the blood. Don't eat the blood of any animal. That's not something that they're allowed to do. They're told many times, you can't do that. That is not something that the people of God do. And even in the New Testament, it says, don't eat animals with the blood still in it. You can't do that. So what they would do is they would take the animal, they would take the sacrifice, and they would give it, and its body is broken. The body is prepared. The body is put on the altar. But that blood is poured out and given back to God because it's a sign of respect for that life. It's the image of the life being given. So Jesus is saying, here's my body. It's going to be broken. I'm going to give it for you. I'm giving my body to be the sacrifice. And he's giving his life. He's saying, this is my blood poured out for you. This is the life that's being given for yours. They will come to understand this a little bit better after the crucifixion and everything happens. But I think it's so important for us to stop and realize what he's saying. I'm doing this. I'm giving this for you. And after the sacrifice was made, whenever the people would go to the tabernacle and they would make the sacrifice, what they would do is those who made the sacrifice and their family and the priest who did the sacrificing, they would all join together and they would share a meal over the meat that was left. And in this moment, they communed with God because the sacrifice had been made, because sins had been atoned for, because it had been a peace offering, because it had been, as long as it wasn't one of the offerings that had to be completely burned up, when there was something left, they would share a meal. And those people would get to eat in the presence of God. Jesus is saying, I'm becoming this sacrifice. I'm giving my body and I'm giving my blood. I'm giving my life for you. It's poured out for you. Make no mistake, this is for you. So that we can commune with God. So that we can come and be able to be in the presence of God. It's interesting. As I have studied about communion a lot, actually, in the last couple of years, one of the things that is most misunderstood about us, both in the early church and the ancient traditions, and even today in some parts of the world, is this idea of communion. Sometimes people just straight up think we're cannibals because they look at scripture and they say, well, what are you doing? You're eating what now? You're drinking what now? But what we're doing is we are doing what Jesus says. He says, take this bread. Take this cup. Remember me. And this leads me into the last point here. Jesus says, now do this in remembrance of me. This is really important because this is where he's telling us, no, I want you to do this. Whenever you get together, whenever you break the bread, and whenever you drink from the cup, remember me. Do this because of what I'm doing for you. Remember the sacrifice that I gave. Remember, it was me who was broken. Remember, it was my life that was given. Remember what I have done for you. Remember what it was like before and what it's like now. Remember when I set you free. The reason we continue to take communion is because Jesus says, do this. And when you do it, remember me. This actually becomes something that we call a sacrament. Oh, that's a big word. It just means Jesus told us to do it, so we do it. And this is meant to be one of those times where we know what Jesus has told us to do, and as we do that, then we know he is meeting us in it. As we unite together as the church, as the body of Christ, and we remember his sacrifice, and we remember that it was his body that was given for us, that it was his blood that was poured out for us, And as we come to the table together, we commune with God. This is one of the reasons we call it communion. This is when we commune with Him. He meets us in this moment. It's something we celebrate together, but this is something that every believer is called to do, and we spend this moment with our Father. So what we're going to do this morning is we are going to take communion together. We are going to pass the plates, and we are going to just take a moment and really remember what He has done. We are going to remember the sacrifice that was given for us. We are going to remember this work that He did in us, that Passover is not done because He saved us, and we believe that He is still working, and we know that someday that we will go to heaven, and it is because of Jesus on the cross. We know that He gave His body and He gave His blood for us. And we just are going to stop for a moment, and we are going to remember, and we are going to thank Him, and we are going to come before Him, and we are going to say, God, please meet us in this. We believe He is present, that He is living, that He is active, that He is here, and He will meet us in this moment. Before we head into the time of communion, though, I want to take a moment and just allow you to prepare your hearts. We are going to be able to come and commune with God our Father. Let us just take a moment and prepare our hearts. Let us speak to Him. If we have anything that we need to bring to Him and we need to confess to it now, if we just want to utter a thanks for who He is and what He has done, do that. We invite anybody who has faith in Jesus to take communion with us. And if this is a moment where you have not yet placed your faith in Jesus, this is a moment where you can say, yes, I choose, I believe, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord. We'll just take a moment and prepare our hearts.
Lord, I want to see Your face. Pass me by the crowds of people, the priests who sing their praise. I hunger and thirst for Your righteousness, but it's only found one place. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take the coal, cleanse my lips, here I am. Take the coal, cleanse my lips, here I am.
You who are walking in fellowship with God and are in love and harmony with your neighbors, and you who do truly and earnestly repent of your sin and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from this time in His holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort. Meekly make your humble confession to Almighty God. Let's pray. O God of grace and mercy, we thank You that You ever loved us and provided for our redemption. We thank You for Your Son who died to save us and for Your Spirit who invites us to draw near. Guide us now as we commemorate the suffering of our Lord Help us remember the cost of our salvation. Help us commune with you and each other, and so consecrate the bread and wine which are here prepared, that as we partake of them, we may receive the spiritual benefits of Christ's broken body and shed blood. In his name we pray. Amen. Would our communion stewards come forward, please? We're going to pass the bread and hold it. We'll take together, okay? Go ahead. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Take and eat this, remembering that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Drink this, remembering that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Song, standing, seated, praying, however it is that the Holy Spirit leads you. Let's continue to worship Him.
Your grace is enough, more than I need. At your will, I will.
Jesus, light the way.
name together today. So thankful that we can hear your word and lift up our voices in song to celebrate you. If our offering ushers will come forward, we'll take offering. I will pray and ask God to bless it before we do announcements. Lord, we thank you so much. We praise you this morning, endlessly in our hearts, God. As we enter this time where we're worshiping you in a different way, God, we pray that your presence remains and leads us each step of the way. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, to mark on our calendars this week, today, February 19th, meet at the church at 5 p.m. for the youth. They're going to go over to Welcome Wesleyan for a joint youth service. February 22nd will be Ash Wednesday service from 5 to 6 p.m. And there are details for that for anyone who wants more information on that in the bulletin. And then on February 26th, there will be a meeting, the local board association administration after church. I keep forgetting what the A stands for in the OBA. And that is it. I just pray that we are all united with God as we are everyday missionaries in our everyday mission field.